Right. Welcome, everybody, and thank you for joining us for Axis's first crypto summit. I'm Amie Stepanovich. I am the U.S. Policy Manager at Axis, and this is Jamie Tomasello, Axis's Technology Director. Axis is an international organization that extends and defends the digital rights of users at risk around the world. By combining innovative policy, user engagement, and direct technical support, we fight for open and secure communications for all. I want to open with a special thanks to our fearless leader, Brett Solomon, who's in the audience somewhere. Thank you, Brett. To our policy director, Ramon, to our technology director, who you'll be hearing from in just a second, and to the entire Axis team. If you could all stand up for just a second. If any of you have any questions today, if you could direct them to our Axis team members, kind of stationed around the room, and we'll try to answer them to you and make sure that the rest of the day goes very smoothly. Mostly because I'm going to open with a warning. Today we're all guinea pigs. For the next few months, starting today, we're going to try a few new things, and we thank you for coming out and trying them with us.
And we should start by asking, why encryption? One answer is that it's our primary method of protecting ourselves and the data we share online. It underscores many of the services we frequently use, including banking and health, and increasingly, the methods we use to communicate. But some uses of cryptography may have implications for national security. We need to Our decisions about encryption don't just matter for today's headlines. They will shape the future of the internet as we know it. That is why we need to listen and learn, because dashing blindly ahead could stifle the world's most powerful platform for innovation and human rights, while doing nothing at all could lead and has already led to very real vulnerabilities in the tools that we rely upon to live our daily lives. We need to think about encryption not only through all layers of the technology stack, but also across the internet ecosystem, from users to devices to technologies to services to organizations to governments and to infrastructure. The elements of the ecosystem are interdependent. Affecting one element has an effect on the entire system.
As many of you know, the debate over crypto policy has been a long one, both in the US and around the world. As we're about to hear, this is not the first time we've heard many of these arguments for or against backdoors, front doors, end-to-end encryption, or device encryption. But increasingly, we're having two separate arguments, answering different questions in different ways. Just last week, Director James Comey became the most recent government official to call for a debate on these topics. But it's unclear what we're debating. Today, we would like to start to bring people together to get us all on the same page and to see if we can move forward cohesively and perhaps reach some concrete conclusions. And that's why we're conducting this experiment. Our sessions today are designed to frame this debate. We won't be having traditional panels. You're not going to see moderators. You're not going to be asked preordained questions or have panelists talking past one another. We have challenged all of our speakers to challenge themselves and engage with one another in a meaningful format. Now, this experiment may not bring the consensus that we all want. We may end up at each other's throats. But the hope is that by listening to one another, we can figure out where we're in agreement and where we have left to answer questions. And this is just the beginning. Over the next 6 months, we'll be reaching out to all of you, refining the outcomes from today's event, and framing the issues we have in common in a clear format that we'll be taking to San Francisco in March in conjunction with Axis's RightsCon conference, their signature conference on human rights and technology, to push forward to the next step, to find the answers. Here we're looking for the questions, and then we're going to move forward and try to figure out what the answers to those questions really are. So for today, sit back and help us move forward.
So a few quick things we tee up now. For the session, Can Encryption Save Us?, we're going to be exploring two questions. In your professional experience interacting with encryption, what are the biggest challenges posed by the tools and technologies? And what are the biggest opportunities? We're going to be collecting your answers throughout the course of the day before the session in the afternoon, so we're able to intersperse your answers with the answers of our panelists. On your tables, you should see a stack of note cards. Please put your answers to those questions on those note cards, and you can give them to any Axis staff member or up to the registration desk in advance of that session.
So let's begin. We're starting today with a session on the history of encryption policy, the debates in the US, and we're joined by some of the brightest minds working on tech policy in the 1990s. before there really was tech policy. They're here to tell their war stories, so please join me in welcoming our first speakers. Marc Rotenberg is the executive director at Epic. Michael Nelson is on the policy team at CloudFlare and was formerly at the White House Office of Science and Technology Policy. Emery Simon is counselor to the Software Alliance, or BSA. Brian LaMacchia is a computer security specialist at Microsoft. Melanie Teplinsky is a professor at American University's Washington College of Law and is on the advisory board for CrowdStrike, Inc. Alan Davidson is the director of digital economy at the Department of Commerce. And unfortunately, Peter Swire couldn't join us here today, so we have taped comments from Peter Swire, who is right now on an airplane, and sends his regrets for not being able to be here in person. Peter Swire is at Georgia Tech University as a professor and was formerly on the President's Independent Review Group on Communications Technologies. So welcome to all of you, and we look forward to hearing your stories. We'll start with Marc.
Well, thank you, Amie. Thank you, Access. And it's great to see all of you here. I have to tell you, as you're going to hear a little bit more about our history, when we got started in the early days of the crypto wars, there were very few people in Washington who were interested in this issue. And one of the very first things we had to do was generate public interest and generate a public discussion even before we could tell people which side of the debate they were supposed to be on. So it's just fantastic that you're putting this event together. And I'm going to fill in, I guess, the early years. I'm going to take the period 1984 to 1994, because actually all good privacy stories begin with 1984. And 1984 was, in fact, a big year in Washington, D.C. Everyone was talking about George Orwell's famous book and the future of civil liberties and whether Orwell got it right if we were there already or whether it was a few years off. And significantly for our community, just a year earlier, Jim Bamford had published a book called The Puzzle Palace. It was a book about an agency which hardly anyone had ever heard of, called the National Security Agency. And in this book, Bamford described the extraordinary computing capabilities of the NSA. So we added that to our discussion about 1984, and I was working with the ACLU at the time, helping them understand new computer technology and trying to understand the implications for public policy. One of the things we did in 84 actually was begin the process that led to ECPA, the Electronic Communications Privacy Act, because people were asking questions then about stored email and digital communications and whether you needed a warrant to get access. The other big thing that happened in 1984 that you need to know about is that a man named John Poindexter, who was the National Security Advisor for President Reagan, wrote a presidential directive called NSDD 145. John Poindexter, by the way, is a familiar name in the civil liberties community, because a few years later, he re-enters the story with the bright idea of total information awareness. But we'll come back to that later. 1984, Poindexter and NSDD 145. And what does NSDD 145 say? It says that the National Security Agency should be responsible for computer security standards within the United States. This was not an act of Congress. This was not based on public hearings. It was simply a determination that the president's national security advisor had made. And many people in Washington in 1984 were very concerned about this. It really did look like Big Brother. And we worked with the ACLU to help organize civil liberties advocates and lawyers and technologists to oppose this plan. In Congress, legislation was introduced called the Computer Security Act. And what the Computer Security Act did was to reassert the role of a civilian agency. Then it was the National Bureau of Standards. It later became NIST at the Department of Commerce, to say that all computer research should be done in the open. It should be subject to public review. It should not be done by a military agency, the NSA. That law passes in 1987, by the way, the year after ECPA passes, updating the Federal Wiretap Act. So it looks like things are heading in a good trajectory, but here's where the story gets interesting. After the Computer Security Act is passed, NIST needs to sit down and develop a new digital signature standard.
And NSA says to NIST, tell you what, we can help you with that. We've got all these expert technologists. We've got a lot of background. We're going to help you write that standard. So they enter into a memorandum of understanding describing the relationship between the NSA and NIST. Well, I get a hold of this MOU, and I helped draft the Computer Security Act of 1987, and I said, this is entirely upside down. This is going to put NSA back in charge of computer security standards in the United States, which is exactly what Congress had tried to stop when the law was passed just recently. I'm going to read to you, if I might, just one paragraph from a letter we wrote to Congress. This is 1989, by the way. The cryptographers haven't yet entered the picture. They will, but this is the debate taking place in Congress. Regarding the recently announced memorandum of understanding, we would restate our concern that the NSA should not set the agenda for computer security for the federal government. NSA's responsibilities as set out in the MOU are potentially very broad. For example, the MOU suggests that the NSA will be solely responsible for the development of encryption technologies. However, it is becoming increasingly clear that data encryption may be the most important method for enhancing the security of computer networks and the privacy of messages that travel along those networks. The Internet Advisory Board recently proposed the development of digital envelopes to protect the security, privacy, and authenticity of messages transmitted across the entire Internet. The cornerstone of this security plan we wrote in 1989 is data encryption. Well, there's a lot more that happens over the next few years. The FBI introduces its own proposal to gain access to telephone communication. You've probably never heard this before, but what you know as CALEA and what we called at the time the digital telephony proposal was originally designated by the FBI with a code name Operation Root Canal. If you want to understand the FBI's interest in network communication, check out Operation Root Canal. As both of these initiatives by the NSA and the FBI were gaining steam in 1990 and 1991, we actually organized the first cryptography policy conference here in Washington, D.C., and we brought together cryptographers and lawyers and others to talk about how to establish appropriate public policies. And by the way, we did have the NSA and the FBI in the room. At least they told us afterwards that they were there. 1992, the FBI is pushing forward with CALEA, and some people are saying maybe there's a way to make this work if the telephone companies get paid for the modifications they need to make for law enforcement access and we have legal standards. Maybe it won't be so bad if there are back doors to network communications. We said we thought that was a terrible idea, that we had to draw a clear line. And when the NSA put forward the Clipper encryption scheme, in 1993, we began to organize cryptographers and lawyers to oppose that effort. And I'm going to end with this story about the first internet petition. When the plan for Clipper became public, we put together a group of leading experts, 42 technologists and civil liberties advocates, and we wrote respectfully to President Clinton, and we said we thought this would be a mistake. Not only in terms of the privacy and civil liberties impact that it would have on the internet, but also on the stability and security of network communications. We posted the letter online, and something very interesting happened. People began to write to us, and they said, well, I don't really understand what Clipper's about or what cryptography is, but you seem to make some good points. Could I please add my name to your letter? Now, this is early 1994, and there aren't a whole lot of people using the internet at that time. I don't think there were really any commercial services, maybe AOL, something like that, CompuServe, perhaps. And as they wrote to us, we added their name to our letter. And what started with a letter from 42 experts became a petition, which I have here. This was signed by over 50,000 people in the span of 6 weeks, and we delivered it to the White House. And by 1994, the battle to stop the Clipper chip was well underway. I'll stop there.
I'm Mike Nelson. I work for CloudFlare now, which is a web security company providing end-to-end encryption to more than 2 million websites around the world. But 22 years ago, I was in the Clinton White House arguing with Marc Rotenberg. So in a way, I am the ghost of crypto past. In addition to working at CloudFlare, I also teach internet studies at Georgetown. I've been doing that in my spare time for the last 7 years. And as a professor, I have to do what Marc just did, which is give you some reading assignments. If you really want to understand what we're talking about and what happened in the clipper chip debate back in the 90s, I really recommend that you read Stephen Levy's book, Crypto, How the Code Rebels Beat the Government, Saving Privacy in the Digital Age. It's still the best, most comprehensive analysis of what went on. He interviewed all the right people and did a very nice job of detailing who was in what position and what the battle was really about. If you do not have time to read the entire book, you might go online and find an article that he wrote in 1994 called The Cypherpunks Versus Uncle Sam. That's Whit Diffie on the cover. It was in the New York Times Magazine, Sunday Magazine. And again, he does a great job of outlining what this is all about. What I'm going to do in 7 minutes is quickly share a few lessons I learned in the time I was in the White House. I had been Senator Gore's science advisor back in the late 80s when he was chair of the Senate Science Subcommittee. I did not help him invent the internet, but I did help him commercialize it. And when he got a promotion and went to the White House, I went with him and worked with the president's science advisor. One of the very first issues I got pulled into was the clipper chip debate. It turned out that the first Bush administration had been struggling with this question of how do we provide better encryption while ensuring law enforcement and intelligence access to communications. And what had sort of pushed the issue to the forefront was that AT&T was about to offer very strong encryption over a telephone device. It was about a $3,000 device that companies could use to do military-grade encryption. And law enforcement and the intelligence community was freaking out. So we came into office, and there was this envelope that had been waiting there for several months because the Bush administration wasn't going to carry this project forward, but somebody needed to do something to address this issue. It was a very different time because at the time, there were tight controls on what kind of encryption you could send around the world. There were tight export control limits. They didn't affect directly what could be done in the US, but they certainly affected what companies from Microsoft to AT&T to the internet companies could do. So the proposal that was put forward by the National Security Council was to come up with the clipper chip, which was very strong encryption with a front door. And it was sort of the compromise solution. At the time, the FBI would just have soon banned encryption entirely. Of course, Department of Commerce, business community wanted very strong encryption everywhere, no front doors. But in the end, this was the proposal put forward. Marc, as you said, argued against it. I was the civilian point man on this issue, so I got to explain to all my friends why this was a good idea. And this is where I learned one very important thing. Never get involved in a policy debate where your only good arguments are classified at the top secret code word level. The other thing I learned was very important was that when Gore was handed this assignment by President Clinton, because he had been deputized to do technology and telecom issues, Gore was smart enough to say, wait a minute, this has huge commercial implications. Get Mike Nelson read in on this. And the National Security Council staff said, oh, we can't tell Mike Nelson about this. This is classified and he doesn't have a clearance. Whereupon Gore said, get him a clearance. And I got the fastest clearance ever issued, I think, and was brought into the discussion. And this, I think, is a key thing that happened right in the debate. Gore showed the leadership and pushed all the agencies together to have a real multi-stakeholder discussion. That's what we would call it today. He really did bring the different players together. The other thing I learned as I was involved in this debate was that stories really matter. You remember Jim Kallstrom, our favorite FBI official. He was head of the New York office. He was going around the country and on the press, on Capitol Hill, telling the story from the point of view of an FBI agent. And always starting with, your daughter has been kidnapped. The FBI is trying to find the kidnappers. We're tapping into their phone and we can't understand what they're saying. That was always the frame he had. And that kind of argument was very effective on Capitol Hill. A lot of representatives and senators didn't want to be the person who stood in the way of the FBI. Luckily, counter stories matter too. And over the 4 years I was working on this issue at the White House, other stories developed. And the most powerful story was the Federal Reserve has been hacked due to weak encryption. It's the Clinton administration's fault for holding back strong encryption. So we actually had a sort of a battle of the stories. The other thing I learned is ease of use matters. The reason Clipper Chip didn't work was that it was a hardware solution. One company made it. It wasn't something that could be easily built into all systems. In the end, the second round of Clipper Chip was key escrow encryption. That was a software proposal, but it still wasn't easy to use. It still wasn't something everybody could build into their systems. And that's in the end why key escrow did not take off. The other really important lesson I learned was that in this area, you have to have a lot more transparency to build more trust. When the Clipper Chip came out, the administration recruited some of the very top crypto experts and gave them access to the source code and had them look at it. That wasn't adequate. The only way a key escrow solution could ever have been accepted is if the whole world could have looked at open source code and evaluated it and see that it did what it said it did. The other thing I learned was that you can really get in big trouble from a soundbite. As a matter of fact, you can almost get fired. If you look at this article in the New York Times Magazine, you will see that across the top of the index of the magazine, which is the only page everybody who reads the Sunday New York Times reads, there is a little soundbite that says, according to Mike Nelson, quote, this is the Bosnia of telecommunications. Unfortunately, it didn't include the rest of the quote, which was, if we don't get this right, thousands of people will die. Very fortunately, it did not include the last part of the quote, which was, and I feel like one of those UN peacekeepers in the middle being shot from all sides. It really is important in these issues to boil it down, to get to the essence of the issues, and I'm glad that in some of the debates we're having today, we really are focusing on what really matters, and I hope that as we get forward, both sides of this issue will be able to express clearly, with facts, what's really happening. At CloudFlare, we're strong believers in encryption, protecting our customers, protecting free speech around the world, but we also understand that law enforcement has real concerns, and we have to give them some other tools other than universal wiretapping to help them do their job. So thank you very much.
Good morning, my name is Emery Simon, and I think I'm the oldest person here, so I've been around these various policy debates for a long time. I hate the term crypto wars because it suggests a confrontation over goals. I think the confrontation is over means. So the goal we all share, the goal is how to balance the concept of personal liberty and personal security. We use encryption. I represent businesses. Businesses use encryption not to frustrate the NSA or the CIA. We use encryption to earn customer trust and protect users, protect commercial data, personal data. So the notion that somehow the objective that we seek is deliberate and purposeful to frustrate law enforcement or national security is just wrong. So that's an important concept to kind of keep in mind as we proceed through the day, because I think it's easy to fall into the trap of a notion of it's us against them. It's a disagreement over means. It's not necessarily a disagreement over purpose. The encryption fights of the 90s were really two different things. One was export controls, which Mike mentioned. The other one was Clipper chip. Clipper chip sort of has gone away. The export control issue remains. And at some point in this discussion, it might be interesting for us to talk about the most recent manifestation of that, which is U.S. implementation of Wassenaar obligations on certain intrusion tools, which are a necessary element of effective encryption technologies. And it's hard to separate this into bits because it's a whole. It's also noteworthy that encryption is simply one form of security technology use. It's not the sole form. And relying only on encryption would never really get you security. And although debate focuses on that because that's where law enforcement and national security communities feel their frustration, the security, as I'm sure others will talk about, it has to be a comprehensive approach, and all the best tools available need to be used. All right, with that kind of by way of some framing concepts, let me read to you 8 points that were presented in testimony before the Senate Judiciary Committee in 1999, presenting the industry point of view in that context. And some of the points will seem a little dated to you, but some of these points should resonate pretty well because the debate remains, the focal points of the debate, I think, remain the same. So we, and at the time, BSA was part of a large industry group called Americans for Computer Privacy, which included a lot of public interest groups, industry groups, cryptographers and others, and in a lot of ways, we sort of became the policy focal point from a business perspective for that debate. All right, so here's what we said in testimony before the Senate Judiciary Committee. We strongly believe in a voluntary cooperative partnership between government and industry. It is the only approach that can succeed in protecting critical infrastructure. Critical infrastructure was the thought of the time. It still remains an important thought today, and it's, again, part of the overall mix. It's not just about bad actors and criminals. To achieve this, the private sector proposes that it take some actions and the government take some actions. So on our part, companies need to keep improving information security, just like they have been doing for years. That's still what companies are doing. That's what companies are going to keep on doing. Bad guys keep on catching up. We need to stay ahead of them. Second, we all have to practice good security hygiene. And by that, we meant that everybody needs to be conscious of how they deal with security, and everybody needs to take steps on their own to protect themselves, protect their systems, protect their private lives, protect their public lives. And third, industry needs to share information among itself and with the government about threats and vulnerabilities, as well as best practices. Lo and behold, we have an information sharing bill pending in Congress today. We've had these bills pending off and on for the last 20 years. History continues. All right, as for the government, we came up with 5 points. First, it is important that the government to share information quickly with the private sector. So this is about collaboration in common security, and the best security systems come, as I mentioned a moment ago, from information sharing. Second, the government should lead by example. This is an ironic one. So the government should lead by example. Government needs to do a better job protecting its own computer systems. That was 1999, still painfully relevant today. Having been a former government official, got a letter from OPM saying, you may have been hacked. third, government needs to increase training of law enforcement personnel, including those of state and local levels. And we, industry, strongly support funding for this purpose. One of the undercurrents of the current discussion is that there has been some underfunding, particularly at law enforcement, FBI, and other agencies, in their cybersecurity capabilities. And part of the frustration is that they feel like they've fallen behind the curve, not because they're not smart and good, but because they've underfunded the purpose. One way to fix that is not to dumb down technology. One way to fix that is to fund it properly. Fourth, the government needs to strengthen its own technology capabilities. Fifth, we support the idea of a new cybersecurity scholarships and creation of cyber core and investing in educational institutions in training students in cryptographic skills. And fifth, we are concerned about the possibility of overreaction to recent, in those days, denial of service attacks and internet viruses. And we said, in closing, it is essential the government not use legitimate threats to computer security as a justification for assuming new powers of regulation or imposing new burdens on industry. The motivation today is a little different. The motivation today is personal security, national security, but the concepts are same. And the fact that there is a problem should not create a foundation for overreaction. So I'll stop there. Thank you.
So thank you and good morning. I'm Brian LaMacchia. I run the security and cryptography team at Microsoft Research, which is the basic research arm of Microsoft in Redmond. I started doing research in cryptography as an undergraduate co-op student at AT&T Bell Labs in 1989 when, for the summer, my mentor Andrea Lisko and I decided to attack Sun Microsystems' secure RPC remote procedure call protocol, which used a Diffie-Hellman key exchange with 192-bit prime, which will set off a lot of alarm bells for those of you who look at stuff. But at the time, we thought it was pretty good, and they had a challenge problem, and it was a nice thing for us to go and break. But I thought today, instead of talking about early weak crypto systems that we broke, I would focus on export controls a bit, because this is something that we in industry have dealt with. And if you look at the history of industry products shipped since the early 90s, starting when Lotus Notes had to ship a weak cipher suite for export, they cut a deal with the US government. They were the first to ship encrypted communications where you got 120 bits if you were in the US or 64 in the US, but only 40 bits if you were exported. By the time Microsoft got a license to the RSA algorithm, and they shipped the first thing known as crypto with a hole in NT4. Now, crypto with a hole was basically a driver model for cryptography, and this went out in 1996. And the idea was that we had a standard set of application interfaces that you could plug your own cryptography into. Well, that's export controlled. Even if you don't ship the crypto themselves, shipping the capability for someone to plug their own cryptography into a product in 1996 was export controlled. And so the deal that Microsoft struck in 96 with the US government in order to ship this in Windows NT4 and Internet Explorer 3, going back a little bit in time, was you could ship crypto with a hole, but you could only plug things into it that Microsoft had signed, digitally signed itself, and Microsoft had to maintain the signing key. And Microsoft effectively became an export agent of the US government so that people could ship things. They had to go to Microsoft first and get signed and show the right licensing. Well, guess who got to go sign that stuff when they became the program manager for crypto in 1997? So one of my first jobs showing up at Microsoft was twice a week to collect on floppy disk a bunch of drivers that various manufacturers had written for the operating system and go into the little vault that we maintained the key in a hardware device and go sign crypto API plugins so that we could then give those back to manufacturers. And you needed one of these if you were making a smart card driver or any other piece of hardware, or you wanted to plug your own algorithms in. And if you were a third-party company and you wanted to develop, you had to certify to us in the US government that you either were shipping weak cryptography, and then it could be signed and it could go anywhere, or you were shipping strong cryptography and it was only going to go to North America, US and Canada. So twice a week you go into the vault. It was a real vault. We built a little room, had some security, some cameras, had a little bank vault we got sort of off the back lot of a bank that went under, had a bunch of combo dials on it. The construction workers who built it thought we were building a vault for Bill Gates' money because it was in the basement of the building where Bill had his office. But no, we weren't putting billions in there. We were putting a bunch of hardware cryptographic modules. And that was what life was like in 96. And surprisingly, while we got a general weakening in export controls in 99, in particular open source software, there's a much more easier way, you basically just notify. And we do that for a lot of our open source crypto today. There are still some controls in place. And there was a further weakening in 2000, there's been a little bit weakening, but even with Windows 10 that's coming out at the end of this month, we have new features that we are shipping. For those of you who know elliptic curve cryptography, we're shipping sort of generic support for any elliptic curve you want. That's still export controlled. And there is the ability to set your own parameters on an algorithm that has general parameters is considered restricted. And there's a hoop you got to jump through if you want to go set the parameters. You can't just go set the parameters directly. You got to go register on a website to download a tool, to type the parameters in, to plug that into Windows so that there's a registration that gets reported to the US government twice a year. And all these hoops have basically not really done anything to stop the spread of strong cryptography, which you can very easily download anywhere. But they still do impact commercial development of the software. And I think that understanding that export control is another lever that gets used to try to control the spread of widespread cryptography and has been going on for 20 years is an important thing to kind of remember in all of this. And I think I'll stop there. Thank you.
So I have some slides. I'm actually going to slide over here so that I can get a clicker. And actually, does it come up here? See if we can get set up. So it's a privilege to be here today with this distinguished panel, and I really want to extend some thanks to Amie and also to Nathan for at Access Now for getting this organized. I can start a little bit while you get the setup. As some of you know, I've loved puzzles since I was a kid. I did my first 500-piece puzzle when I was 3 years old, and I was recovering from eye surgery. And by age 8, I did cryptograms from the Washington Post every week with my dad. My childhood idol wasn't this woman, Madonna, and it wasn't Wonder Woman. It was actually this gentleman, William Friedman. He was the man who, without understanding any Japanese, was able to break the Japanese codes during World War II. By high school, I knew I wanted to be a cryptologist, the fancy term for a code breaker. It was back in the 90s, and the lion's share of cryptographic expertise at the time was still at the NSA. So it was only natural that I wanted to go and work there. I started my technical work at the agency when I was 16. Over the years since, I've worked on encryption from nearly every angle. At the height of the crypto wars, I worked at NIST under Miles Smith in the computer security lab. I worked with Bruce McConnell at OMB, who was working on the loosening of export encryption controls in the 90s. I worked on legal issues under Stuart Baker, who was formerly general counsel for the NSA. And more recently, as an advisor to CrowdStrike, had the opportunity to look at encryption through the cybersecurity lens. With the benefit of these experiences, what I want to do is take you through the whirlwind 6-minute tour of crypto wars. So the crypto wars were triggered in large part because of the need for strong encryption, as several of the panelists have mentioned. Encryption is essential to cybersecurity. It plays a significant role in information assurance. We know this. NSA has a dual mission of SIGINT and information assurance, and that's why. Because it's essential to cybersecurity, one of the things that it does is it's an effective tool in the fight against economic espionage and cybercrime. It's also important for e-commerce, right? For example, we know that we create secure channels for communicating over the internet, ways to send our credit cards over the web, for example. The President's Review Group on Surveillance recently observed that encryption is the essential basis for trust on the internet. And that hasn't changed any in the last number of years. Stephen Levy, who wrote the article that Mike Nelson mentioned, wrote that encryption is the silver bullet by which we can hope to regain our privacy. And it's been described in that way in part because of the confidentiality that it can provide. Confidentiality that can be used by journalists when they're working with confidential sources, all the way to human rights activists and dissidents in foreign countries who are trying to speak out against repressive regimes. Encryption protects confidential records, lists of them here. But we have a fundamental question, right? Law enforcement and national security are concerned. They're worried they're going to lose access to information when criminals start to use strong encryption and when terrorists do the same. We understood this back in 1994. In 1994, Stuart Baker said, "The concern is the prospect that in 5 or 10 years, every phone you buy that costs $75 or more will have an encrypt button on it, and it'll interoperate with every other phone in the country, and suddenly we'll discover that our entire communications network is being used in ways that are profoundly antisocial. If we're going to have a standardized form of encryption, we need to think seriously about what we're going to do when it gets misused." Well, there you have it. It's 5 to 10 years later. All right, it's 20 years later. But there you have it. So the parade of horribles that we've seen trotted out by law enforcement and national securities in the 90s is nearly identical to those that's being discussed now. We weren't talking then about ISIS, but conceptually the arguments really haven't changed much. The FBI came up with a solution to the problem. The FBI's solution was something they call tappability. If something is legally searchable sometimes, it should be physically searchable all the time. So is the FBI right? For 20 years, that's what we've been debating about. The question is, do unbreakable locks lead to privacy? Or do they lead to anarchy? And that's the real issue at the heart of this debate. The essence of the escrow encryption debate is that it offers strong encryption without threatening law enforcement and national security interests. And that's why people look at it. The keys that are needed to decrypt encrypted communications or data are escrowed. They're stored in a way that the government can gain access to the encryption information with appropriate legal authorization. An important piece of this is that the escrow key is divided into two pieces or more so that no one person or agency can decide to use it when they shouldn't be using it. The rhetoric surrounding the escrowed systems is really interesting. Civil liberties advocates always describe it as a backdoor. The FBI has described it as a trapdoor. And most recently, Mike Rogers has described it as a front door. Lots of doors. Doors, locks, and keys. You're going to see a lot of them in this debate. So in any event, it was 1993 when the government proposed what they called the escrow encryption standard, which was one implementation of a key escrow system, EES. EES was a voluntary federal standard. It was designed to secure sensitive but unclassified information. The goal was to get escrow encryption built into mass market software. When EES was proposed back in 1993, there was intense opposition, 50,000 signatures on that petition that Marc Rotenberg showed us. EES was criticized for a bunch of reasons. First, it was developed by NSA with little input from the public. This was Mike Nelson's point a few minutes ago. There was a classified algorithm called SkipCheck. It was developed by the National Security Agency, and the trustworthiness of the design was in question. It was considered suspect. Right, there were concerns that the algorithm had vulnerabilities that could be taken advantage of by the FBI or the National Security Agency. The standard was promulgated without significant congressional input or public input, and it relied on government escrow agents, meaning that the people who wanted to use the keys also held the keys. This held the potential for government abuse. There were liability issues, meaning if a key was lost or stolen, who would be responsible? And there were issues of international acceptance. Strong encryption was available overseas without key escrow, so there was little demand for strong encryption with key escrow. And corporate entities in the United States felt that there would be little foreign market for an encryption system that had the government holding the keys. Also, as proposed, as mentioned earlier, EES allowed for only a hardware implementation, no software implementation, when it was first suggested. We learned from the opposition to EES in the 1990s that there were several issues. We had to deal with who was going to have access to an escrowed encryption system, who would have access to the keys, when they'd have access to those keys, under what circumstances, and who would have liability in the event that certain things happened to the keys. Those were the implementation issues. But there were also issues with respect to the system itself. Was such a system necessary? The arguments were that it weakened security, right? That it would a backdoor would create vulnerabilities in the system, that EES would be ineffective, because criminals would just super encrypt their data with non-key escrowed encryption systems, and that EES would be counterproductive. So I'm coming back to a point Mike Nelson made, which I think is very important. Beware the rhetoric here. The rhetoric here, originally, when law enforcement sought this, this authority, they talked about lawful access. And today what you hear is discussion about exceptional access. The question becomes, are we talking about allowing the government to have an ability to preserve their current ability to get access to data when they have authority, or are we talking about an expansion of government authority? These other questions are similar. They all have to do with how you shape the argument. And in each case, There are very strong words used that are rhetorically strong. And as you point out, you can make the argument on either side rhetorically strong. We need to get beyond the rhetoric. So the question we have is, are there ways to bridge the gaps between the two sides? And how do we make room for innovation and nuanced discussion in what has been a politically charged environment? These are the puzzles on which I think we will all be working for some time to come. Thank you.
We're going to turn to Peter Swire now. Give us a second, and we'll load up the video for you.
Hi, everybody. This is Peter Swire. If you're hearing this, it means my attempt from the West Coast didn't work, so you're getting the tape version. My topic for the crypto wars history is really to focus on 1999, when the decision was finally made to shift which way things would go. And I'm going to talk about the clearance process at OMB. That was important then. It'll turn out to be important today. It means any testimony that goes to the Hill, for instance, has to get cleared by the various agencies and senior advisors. And it means the Justice Department doesn't get to say whatever it wants. It has to have its words in written writing subjected to a lot of other eyeballs. So the story from my part goes, in the beginning of 1999, I came in as chief counselor for privacy. I was in my late 30s, law professor. Suddenly I get to be part of this this issue. And they asked me to be chair of the working group on encryption. And the way clearance works is the working group are the sort of mid-level policy people, and if you can't agree, then it goes up to the deputies, and then it goes up to the principals, like the Secretary of State or whatever. And if it doesn't get clear there, the Chief of Staff or the President has to make a decision. So the thing to realize is that during the 1990s, there was basically a split down the middle of the administration. On one side was the NSA that wanted to have good access to signals intelligence. Also with them were the Department of Justice and the FBI. Attorney General Reno cared a lot about this issue. The FBI cared a lot about the issue for law enforcement purposes. They'd just gone through the CALEA debates, and so they were worried that wiretaps wouldn't work, and now they were worried that encryption was going to come in and stop a lot of communications intelligence as well. Other agencies that were very involved, one was Commerce. Commerce had a role in export controls. They were very allied in those days with the major industry. On the internet, if you want to send from Alice to Bob, it's insecure between Alice and Bob. Unless you have good encryption, bad guys in the middle can read the communication, man in the middle attack, and all that kind of stuff. With them at various points were the vice president, who was allied with Silicon Valley. There might have been White House counsel's office. In some cases, the State Department. But the split was not strong enough to overcome the limits on crypto that especially NSA and DOJ and FBI were at. That started to change during the 1990s. One of the parts that isn't sort of told as often is the role of the Pentagon, the Department of Defense. NSA is part of the Pentagon, and NSA had a big role in encryption debates. But think if you were Deputy Secretary of Defense John Hamry at the time, who had the lead on the issue for them. You had the Army, the Air Force, the Navy. Navy ships have to use encryption. Airplanes have to use encryption. And they're worried on a defensive side, they want to have the best darn protection against people breaking into their communications possible. They also want to have an edge in terms of having command of the information space, breaking into other people's communications. Well, with export controls, the concern was that Israel, Russia, who knows who else, was going to develop leadership on encryption issues. If the strong crypto couldn't come from the U.S., the technological edge could go elsewhere. And so this became an increasing concern for the Pentagon, that the other side, the other military, might have better encryption. We might not have the best stuff. And along with that concern was a concern that they wanted to have a sort of homegrown supply of outstanding encryption inside the United States. And if the U.S. companies were building weak encryption by design under the export controls, then we weren't going to have the best stuff. So as the crypto debates continued, the NSA started to lose more often or have less strong support from within the Pentagon. You can imagine if the Pentagon and the Justice Department say you need it for security, that's one thing. But if the Pentagon and the Justice Department start to be split, then the commerce arguments, the other kind of arguments, can start to have greater greater persuasiveness. So in this working group process, we moved forward. There was a lot of debates about what to do. There was a whole series of questions about what could you give the FBI if they didn't get the limits on strong encryption. There was proposed legislation that would help the FBI in certain ways to give them financial and technical financing, and there was another set of laws that would help them. But one story that happened in this period was the summer of 1999. I've been chairing the sort of mid-level bureaucrats meeting, you know, Scott Charney from Justice, etc. But now, suddenly, I was in my first meeting in the Situation Room, and Attorney General Reno was coming. And when I walked into the meeting, like a good mid-level bureaucrat, I knew my job was to sit in the back row so the grown-ups could sit at the table. But somewhat to my chagrin and surprise, the vice president's person and the president's person, who were my bosses on this issue, they said, well, Peter, no, why don't you sit right there at the table? You've been running this process, and you're technically expert. We'd like you to tell Attorney General Reno that we're changing our policy. And so I had to do that. So we were across a fairly narrow table, and she had not known that was what the meeting was going to be. She was going to make her pitch for why the status quo should stay. And I had to inform her that the president's senior advisors and the president had decided that they were going to go the other way and allow strong crypto. She was really upset. She was surprised. She's a big woman, you know, strong person, much taller than I am. And she leaned over and she spoke loudly and vehemently about how outrageous this was and how terrible it was. And I had to sit there like a timid little mouse, a bureaucrat, and smile and say, well, I'm sorry, Madam Attorney General, I understand your concerns, but this is the way that the administration is going to go. I think a lesson from this is that people know about Congress and lobbying members and staff, but the testimony, the legislative proposals, that clearance process happens with all the different agencies that care. So today it's the State Department with Internet Freedom, it's the Commerce Department, again, that understands the harm to U.S. business if we don't have a good policy here. It can be White House Counsel, it can be OMB, it can be whatever expertise there is in different areas of the government, it can be Office of Science and Technology Policy, which doesn't win as many battles as some of the rest. Importantly, it can be the National Economic Council. These are all, roughly speaking, potential allies in the crypto debates between now and going forward. The NSA, sometimes they have capabilities that are stronger than the FBI. They don't have to prove things in court. They want to have effective tools, but they're not quite as locked out in the cold sometimes as the FBI and prosecutors are. And the state prosecutors are even more locked out because they don't have as many tools to work with as the FBI does. So I think as we look at the debates going forward, we can understand the pain that local prosecutors feel, the pain that the FBI is facing challenges. You know, they say in Washington, where you stand depends on where you sit. And so in these issues, the different parts of the federal government are going to be clashing on this for foreseeable future. It probably means it's going to be very hard for the administration to propose CLIA 2 legislation. Probably the opponents of CLIA 2 are strong enough to stop that. But we'll have to see, and it's going to take constant vigilance and constant work to try to make sure that good technical policy wins out and that we don't undermine human rights and privacy and America's technological leadership. So those are the battles then. They really look similar in their sort of interest group sort of thing to the battles now. And it's up to all of us to continue to work hard and make the good arguments. We succeeded once before, and I think if we do our homework, we can succeed again. Thanks very much. Hi, everybody. This is Peter Swire. If you're hearing this, it means my attempt from the West Coast.
Good morning. I'm Alan Davidson, Director of Digital Economy at the Commerce Department. And I'd like to thank the organizers today for having me and for putting this event together. As someone who worked on encryption policy in the 1990s and now works on it at the Commerce Department, I am delighted to be here. It's a lot of fun. I would note that the Commerce Department itself, as we've heard, has had a major role in this issue due to its leadership on communications policy, technical standards, export controls, data science, and global trade. So I appreciate the opportunity to underscore some of the lessons learned from the 1990s and what they mean today. As a starting point, one observation. By many measures, U.S. encryption policy for the last 15 years has been a resounding success. We don't get to say that very often in Washington. Literally billions of people use encryption today to protect everything from credit cards to credit card numbers to health records. Encryption has become a linchpin of electronic commerce. It supports massive economic growth online. It's protected the security of consumers and businesses around the world. So why then are we here? We're having this conversation again because serious concerns have been raised about the evolution of encryption's use, and the challenges that it poses to the law enforcement and national security communities. We live in a society that values security and safety, as well as liberty and prosperity, and we must take these concerns very seriously. So with that context, I would highlight three quick lessons from the learned in the 90s and how they might apply today. The first is that encryption policy, as we've heard, must be grounded in technical understanding. Terms like asymmetric key length are not exactly household words here in Washington or probably anywhere in the US. So an essential learning of the 90s was that the importance of understanding how encryption works and helping policymakers understand how policy proposals interact with that technology. Marc talked about the technical experts on the Clipper trip. Another great example was the 1997 Risks of Key Recovery, of Key Escrow Report, published by a group of cryptographers and security experts. It was an accessible look at the systemic concerns raised by third-party key recovery, and it played an essential part in building the consensus to disavow third-party key recovery mandates. Today, the need for that kind of technical grounding remains. Important technical questions have been raised about what challenges law enforcement and national security face and how our ability to deal with them may have changed. There are marked differences in the techniques we might use to deal with access to communications versus data in storage versus data in the cloud. We need to understand these technical realities, especially in an increasingly complex environment, a far more complex environment than the one that existed in the 1990s. A second lesson, encryption policy must reflect the realities of a connected global economy. In the 1990s, as we've heard, we learned that encryption was not something we could keep bottled up inside the United States. A turning point in the export control debate was when new versions of US encryption software, like the very popular PGP, Pretty Good Privacy, published by Phil Zimmerman and others, quickly became available around the world. Specifically remember 1993 and again in 1997, versions quickly becoming available. And it became clear that despite our export controls, our adversaries would always have strong encryption available outside of the United States, and US products would be disadvantaged in the market if they couldn't include security tools. That lesson remains true today. Encryption doesn't stop at the border. Other countries are completely capable of building strong encryption, and they do it today. So we must recognize that the bad guys are going to have access to strong encryption. It's going to be available in this interconnected world. Moreover, in a global market, policies that weaken the security offered by US companies will place them at a major competitive disadvantage. These companies are in the best position to understand the demands of a challenging international market for IT products, and weakening encryption will dangerously erode trust and harm US competitiveness. This isn't just an issue of jobs or economic growth, as important as those things are. A strong US internet industry is critical to our own national security. A third and final lesson, policy should reflect encryption's role in protecting security. Another turning point in the 1990s debate was the growing realization that encryption was essential for public safety. We were talking about the Clipper chip, and at the time, the web was barely in existence, right? By late 1999, millions of people were online worldwide. It was apparent very quickly that encryption had this essential role in information assurance, in protecting public safety online. That lesson is true today, too. We still need encryption. And with the challenges we face on cybersecurity, encryption remains an even more essential tool in protecting safety and commerce online. So I just say that taken together, these lessons offer a powerful message today. We must address the concerns of law enforcement and national security, public safety, and global safety. But any encryption policy we adopt must reflect a clear-eyed understanding of the technical, economic, and security realities of the global internet today. I would just close by paraphrasing the president's words on this topic. We want really strong encryption, but we also need to understand the law enforcement and national security issues that it raises and do our best to narrow the gap. We at the Commerce Department hope we can apply the lessons of past debates, and we look forward to working with all of you as we consider the role of encryption in the modern digital economy. Thank you.
Thank all of you. We do have some time for questions. For everybody in the audience, right up front here is Drew Mitnick. He is a policy counsel at Access, and he will be handling questions throughout the day. So feel free to direct them to him, and he'll be circulating with a mic, so just raise your hand if you have a question. We'll start over here with Dave, who's very, very excited about it.
Hi, Dave Perk from Politico. This is a question for the gentleman from the Commerce Department. So,
Hello.
So, you've heard many people say, no doubt, that the imperatives of having a backdoor and the imperatives of actually having strong encryption are irreconcilable. There is no technical solution that accommodate both. So, are you saying that because you want a secure internet for safety and e-commerce, that the FBI is incorrect when it says it wants a front door, back door, whatever, any kind of technical solution that allows the government to bypass encryption?
I go back to the idea that we don't think that these ideas are irreconcilable. And I think the policy of the last 15 years has shown that they're not. That in fact, we do need to hear and understand these concerns. But at the same time, we believe that encryption is an essential tool in protecting privacy and safety.
Wait a minute. That's talking out of both sides of your mouth at the same time. You can't have a back door in the same time have strong encryption. So which is it?
Well, first of all, I don't think that the statement that, well, I was about to say, I don't think that the anybody in the government right now, if you look at what the president has said very specifically, we believe in strong encryption. We don't think that's incompatible with the need to protect public safety. I think I would look back on the debate in the 1990s and say that I think it was very clear at the time, and part of the emerging consensus was an understanding that actually having strong encryption with people having control over that encryption did in fact enhance public safety. So I don't think it's an irreconcilable issue. I reject the premise that it's an either or game, and I think that's been borne out by the last 15 years of experience. And I would also say, you know, there's a robust conversation that's happening now about this, and we'll continue to have it happen. But I think the president has spoken pretty clearly that we at the baseline starting point is we need to have strong encryption for everyone, and that we will continue to keep to find ways to deal with the law enforcement and national security concerns and narrow the gap.
Thank you. I just wanted to add a couple of points. I was commenting to Mike that, Alan, you sound very much like Mike did 20 years ago.
I'm doing my best to channel. I will not mention Bosnia.
Sure. But, I mean, we respect it, and I respected Mike at the time, because the key point here is that both law enforcement and the intelligence communities do have legitimate concerns, and I don't think you can really participate in this debate unless you understand that. But let me also say how we tried to answer this 20 years ago. We do believe very strongly in evidence-based policy. I'd worked for Senator Patrick Leahy when I came out of law school, and Senator Leahy always said, you know, good substance is good policy. And we took that to heart. So for us, in the early days of the crypto wars, one of the things we were doing was a lot of Freedom of Information Act litigation. We were actually trying to understand the scope of the problem. And for me, one of the real aha moments was getting back a FOIA request that we had sent out to the FBI field offices where we asked the question, have you encountered encryption as an obstacle to the execution of a lawful warrant? And the answer in every single document we got was no. Now, subsequent to that experience, we went back to the Federal Wiretap Act and we said, well, what if the government were required on an annual basis to actually provide some data to tell us how many times they encountered encryption and whether there was an obstacle to the execution of a lawful warrant? And that's now in Section 2519 of Title 18. If you look at the most recent wiretap report from the Department of Justice, it says last year The government encountered encryption 25 times. There were only 4 instances where they could not get access to plain text. Now, with those numbers, you can have a meaningful debate, just like we had a meaningful debate with FBI Director Sessions 20 years ago over the Kallstrom scenario. Because the FBI was saying, you know, we've got a person who's been taken hostage, we can't intercept the telephone call, we need to have some way to get access to those communications. And we went and we looked at the annual electronic surveillance reports from the Department of Justice. Wiretapping is almost never used in those scenarios. It's used in investigations of narcotics. That's the primary use of wiretapping. So the data is really important, really important. Last point I just want to say, as much as I respect the FBI's concern on this issue, I don't think we give enough attention to the downside risk of weak encryption. In other words, weak encryption facilitates crime. And if I could say anything about where we are 20 years later, somewhat in opposition to what Alan said a moment ago, I think the lesson we've learned is that we don't have enough strong encryption, that the databases in the private sector and the federal government are too vulnerable because companies have been reluctant to put in place strong crypto.
Just real quick to add on to that, I was really having flashbacks, particularly listening to you try to take both sides of the issue. I was at the Computer Freedom and Privacy Conference at MIT in 1996, taking on Nick Mansfield and Whit Diffie. It was so awkward that C-SPAN filmed it and showed it approximately 20 times over the next 6 months. It was quite a fun debate to have, again, when all your good arguments are classified. The other thing that we haven't mentioned, and I want to mention this, is that this isn't a either-or, you know, strong encryption or weak encryption with backdoors. There's another or, which is let's give law enforcement some new tools, different tools that could be much more effective in finding that kidnapper. And that's what we're not paying enough attention to. The other thing we're not paying attention to is that this isn't just a US issue. What was driving a lot of our concerns when I was in the White House was that the rest of the world, and particularly those countries that the US intelligence agencies were working most closely with, were even more freaked out about military-grade encryption being used by the bad guys than US intelligence agencies were. And so solutions are gonna have to come in a way that doesn't just serve the needs of US agencies. They're gonna have to really work across the board, and they're gonna have to be finding new tools, as I said, that aren't just revolving around encryption.
Hi. It's been about, well, since the late 90s that my day job involved technology policy, but I've been with this a long time. I was one of the 3 lawyers on the House Intelligence Committee when the original FISA was written, so I've been following this for a long time. My question is, it seems history says that government will always break encryption. No matter how good encryption gets, government's always found a way to break it. But the people who propose the strongest encryption seem to think there's an ultimate level at which government won't be able to do that. If you accept that no matter how good encryption gets, government will always be able to break it, how would that change your point of view about how encryption and government regulation should coexist?
I would actually suggest you defer that question to a later panel. I see Nick Sullivan back there who can answer some of those questions. I do think we should realize that the math is pretty bulletproof. The actual encryption algorithms are basically unbreakable now. It's the way they're implemented that leaves the holes. And that's often what intelligence agencies are able to exploit. It's not the actual encryption itself, it's the systems that the encryption routines are embedded in. But I would challenge your assertion that we're always going to be able to break encryption. I think we're at a point now where we have some very good code. It's been time tested. It's open source, so thousands of the world's best cryptographers have pounded on it. I think we have to accept that there's going to be very strong encryption out there, and hundreds of millions of people are going to use it every day.
Let me add a little bit to that, because from a technical perspective, whenever you look at an encryption algorithm, we estimate what the work factor is to break it, but using the best known, you know, techniques. So if you are talking about a public key encryption algorithm today, and I have an RSA key size, I can give you an estimate of how much work it would take using the best known factoring algorithm today to attack it. And if that exceeds the heat death of the universe, I generally don't worry about it, okay? Now, encryption algorithm, this is something that I fight inside of Microsoft every single day. Every time you code an algorithm in place, you are writing a piece of code that will degrade over time, okay? And that's because the attack capabilities of everybody in the world grow as our ability to compute more per minute, right? As our computes get more powerful, as our knowledge about attack mechanisms gets more powerful, as our factoring algorithms get more powerful in that case. So there is a natural degradation that happens, and that's why you see industry over time crank up the minimum key sizes that we recommend, and we deploy stronger algorithms, and there's a natural progression in that. You've seen this in the US government too, whereas the standards starting from the data encryption standard in the 70s, getting replaced with AES, and stronger hash functions and things like that. So there is a natural assumption that for whatever your capabilities are, that at some point over time those things will break, and whether they break before or after the heat death of the universe is something to debate. Every so often, computer science research will have some sort of quantum, some sort of, you know, leap, okay? I use quantum because that's the next thing that's that we're all worried about, which is that if it becomes feasible, for example, to build a quantum computer of reasonable size, and that's a very debatable, long-term, science fiction-y thing, then some of our algorithms are going to fall, okay? And there's an active area of research right now and in trying to develop algorithms that are resistant to that future attack. So that's part of what we do as researchers, right? Is we try to predict how someone's going to attack something down the road, and because the information you encrypt today, you still want to keep private 50 years from now, let's say, I have to figure out what somebody might be able to do 50 years from now and give you enough defensive power today to keep your private information private.
I would also just jump in very quickly to say government is not a monolith in this area, so the capabilities of, for example, national security establishment may be very different than, as we've heard, from the FBI or from a local county sheriff. And so we just have to recognize that's part of what is driving this debate.
Hi, Kevin Bankston, Open Technology Institute. I look forward to talking more about what Mike Nelson was saying about what are the other options we need to be discussing and how does this play out internationally. But I wanted to focus on something else based on some of Comey's comments in the testimony last week that points to an angle of this discussion that I haven't heard talked about before. And that may answer the question of how can the government say we are for strong encryption while also saying we want access to everything we want access to. He made reference to the fact that, well, you know, there are a wide variety of services that we would say, and they would say, are secure, and yet somehow they're able to give us what we want. And in many cases, they have that architecture because of their own business purposes. Why can't just everything else be built like that? And I read that to mean we'd really like to see fewer end-to-end solutions like, say, iMessage and WhatsApp, and more communication solutions like, say, Gmail or Facebook Messages, where although it is encrypted on the wire and likely encrypted on the disk in a way that the provider has the key, they still have access to the content. So I guess my question is, do you see the government's position essentially blessing a certain type of business model for communications online, such that they would rather see a world where all the encryption the provider has the key to all the encryption, and that in essence this is not a campaign against encryption per se, but really a campaign against end-to-end encryption?
Well, if I could just jump into the Wayback Machine again and go back to the 1990s. Kevin, I think your question does reflect a deep philosophical divide, and it's not easy to bridge. The question that we confronted with Kalia and Clipper was basically, you know, does law enforcement pursuant to lawful authority have the right to search and seize, you know, evidence regarding the commission of a crime, which few of us, I think, would dispute, by the way, or does law enforcement have the right to pre-search, to create the infrastructure or the circumstances that enable the subsequent collection of evidence once the crime provides the predicate. And that is at the heart of this debate. And by the way, it's not just about encryption technology. It's also about data retention, where the government makes similar claims on businesses to retain information prospectively in case there's need for information gathering. And I think there actually we do get to draw a line. I think CALEA was a mistake. I think it seeded a view that allowed the government to say, in effect, we want a world in which things are retained for us that we might need in the future. I don't want that world. I think it puts us all at risk, and I think we have suffered enormously through the massive data breaches as a consequence of this design. Now, I think from Comey's perspective, he's unlikely to cede his desire to operate in that world, because that world is easier for him. It makes it easier for him to fulfill his mission, which is an important mission, to be sure. But I think at some point we're going to have to decide, and ultimately it's Congress and it's the courts, if we will continue down that road. I think it's dangerous. I actually think it's led to more crime.
So just a couple of thoughts. FBI Director Comey was actually very careful in saying that he wasn't looking for legislation, he wasn't looking for back doors or front doors. But as a practical matter, what he ended up saying was companies need to have keys, because when I ask a third party for data, you have to be able to produce it. That's an escrow system through a different structure. And we've had lots of debates about what escrow systems do or don't do. So that doesn't quite work. One of the things the FBI has not done has been very clear about what it needs to accomplish the job. There's lots and lots of information. Some of it is the specific in the clear communications, but there's lots you can learn from metadata. There's lots you can learn lots of other ways. So I think we need a little bit of clarity around what it is that people are looking for and how systems can or can't accommodate that without creating vulnerabilities. Last thought. There are two important constitutional provisions at work here. One is the Fourth Amendment, and one is the Fifth Amendment. When you shift all the responsibility to third parties to produce data, you have, in a sense, circumvented the Fifth Amendment, because the individual's assertion of rights becomes much more attenuated. In addition, it's entirely unclear whether a service provider, whether it's Dropbox or Google or Apple, can assert Fifth Amendment rights on behalf of the customer. Probably can't. So there's a more complicated debate here about how we view the constitutional rights and the balance that we have built into the system, and by trying to shift the responsibilities to all of the third parties and putting all the burden on the Fourth Amendment instead of looking at the full range of the constitutional protections.
All right, so one of the things I may not have mentioned at the beginning is the importance today of running on time. So in that spirit, I'm going to thank our amazing panelists for being here and for answering your questions and providing our history. Thank you all.